Okay, so we are talking about the assumptions that we had in Bernoulli's theorem. So the first assumption is that it is inviscous fluid. Okay, there is a bigger equation that is called Navier-Stokes theorem. The outcome of that will be Bernoulli's theorem if you consider it to be inviscous and if you consider it to be laminar flow. Alright, and second assumption it is that it is incompressible. So if fluid, if it is compressible, the pressure force will do work in compressing the fluid also. Okay, that we have ignored. Alright. Third will be what? Third assumption? Okay, announce. Okay. Third assumption is what? A laminar, why are you forgetting that? It's a laminar flow. Laminar flow. Okay? And the fourth one, it is irrotational flow. The fluid should not rotate like that. Getting it? So these are the assumptions that we had when we were talking about the Bernoulli's theorem in fluid dynamics. Clear? Okay. So we are going to discuss few properties that do not have these assumptions. For example, the most important property of the fluid which differentiates between between honey and oil is what? Viscosity, right? Honey is not able to flow as freely as the oil is flowing or water is flowing. Okay? But that kind of differentiation, these equations do not take care of it. Because they will assume that if pressure difference is something, the rate of flow will be same whether it is honey or whether it is oil. Volume flow rate I am talking about. Okay? So now we are going to talk about one of the most important property of fluid, which is viscosity. Please write down viscosity. So whenever we encounter this term viscosity, immediately the flow of the honey will come in our mind. That usually is the case. Okay, so you will see that, you know that the thicker fluid, for example honey, doesn't flow very easily. So suppose you have little bit of honey on this plane, on that plane you have little bit of water. If you incline it like that, due to their own weight, water will flow suddenly and honey will take time to flow. Are you getting it? Alright, now tell me one thing, that the amount of deformation, let's talk about this. Flow is what? Shear deformation. How much the upper layer is moving relative to the lower layer, that is what is flow, that we have discussed. Okay, for example, if let us say this is a fluid body, let's say this is honey itself. Okay, now if the upper surface is moving relative to the lower surfaces, the situation will be something like this. The upper surface moves forward, the lower surface remains here and lower than that further, like this, right? So there is a displacement of the upper surface compared to the lower one, like that. Okay, now tell me one thing, this movement of the upper surface, if you apply a small amount of force, will be more where, in case of honey or in case of oil? If I leave it for large amount of time, sufficient amount of time, will honey stop flowing after some time if you keep on applying force? It will not stop, it will move, but it is moving slowly. Are you getting it? The amount of deformation will be similar whether it is oil or whether it is honey, but it is the rate at which it is getting deformed will be different. that differentiate a more viscous fluid from a less viscous fluid. Whereas in case of solid, the solid get deformed little bit and it stops, because the resistance force is equal to what force you are applying. So it will stop there. But fluid offers almost zero resistance against the flow. So if you apply a small amount of force also, it will slowly and slowly get displaced. Alright? So if I have to quantify viscosity, now we have discussed the viscosity in terms of words only, that there should be something like viscosity which takes care of the fact that some fluid is moving slowly, as in flowing slowly, and some fluid is flowing faster. Okay, so there we need to quantify the viscosity. Right now we have just discussed the concept of viscosity. Alright, so we are going to take the concept from the solids chapter and try to define the coefficient of viscosity. Ultimately it is a shear deformation only, right? And you remember, in case of solid we have defined the shear modulus or the modulus of rigidity. What was that, you remember? G was equal to force divided by area of cross section divided by delta, it is theta only, which is, if you consider a solid getting deformed, then theta is roughly equal to x by L. Yes or no? So this is x by L. This was the modulus of rigidity. If G is more, what does it signify? If G is more, you can see that F by A is equal to G times x by L. So F is equal to G x by L into A. So if G is more, for the same amount of displacement of the upper surface x, I need to apply more amount of force. Yes or no? And this is the force of resistance also. Fine. So in a way, G, the constant G, signifies how strong the material is. Yes or no? Alright. Similarly, similar kind of parameter I am going to define for the viscosity also. Okay. But with viscosity, x is infinite. X will never stop deforming. But the velocity of deformation will be different. So I will define, just like G is defined, I will define a constant for viscosity which is called coefficient of viscosity, denoted by eta. Okay, this eta is equal to force divided by the area of the upper surface, force of resistance between the two layers divided by the area of cross section, divided by what? Velocity of the upper surface divided by length. Are you getting it? Rather than writing x by L would have been what? Strain. Okay? And V by L is what? Derivative of this, dx by dt divided by L, which is strain rate. Rate of deformation is strain rate, which will be different among the fluid. Alright, a more viscous fluid have lesser strain rate than a less viscous fluid. Okay, so I am not using x by L because we cannot quantify x by L in case of liquids. So we are using strain rate. Please write down. Strain rate is V by L, and this is coefficient of viscosity. Fine. Okay. Now, if coefficient of viscosity is more, it automatically indicates that the force of resistance between the two layers is more. Okay. It, viscous force is like a frictional force between the two layers. Alright. And this V is what? V is a relative velocity between the two layers. Are you getting it? V is a relative velocity. Both the layers are moving the same velocity, then V is zero. Okay? So both the layers should be moving with different velocity. So V is a relative velocity. Now we will consider cases, most of the time we'll be considering cases in which the bottommost layer is at rest. Okay? It is a scenario like this. The fluid is kept on the surface. The example of honey that we have taken, in which honey is kept on a plane and we are inclining the plane like that. The lowermost layer of the honey is in contact with the ground. It will move with the ground. So if ground is stationary, the lowermost layer is stationary. Okay, but the uppermost layer will have some velocity. Let's say V is the velocity. Okay, so if you consider relative velocity between the lowermost layer and the uppermost layer, then you can consider this as thickness. Okay, but this layer has some velocity. If you consider relative velocity between this layer and that layer, then you have to consider this as the thickness, L. Fine. So just to make it simpler, we are considering the lowermost layer and the uppermost layer. So the actual velocity becomes a relative velocity if the lowermost layer is attached to the fixed ground. Alright? Any doubt? Now tell me the unit of viscosity. Quick. What should be the units of viscosity? It cannot be zero. The thing is that if you are applying force, if you apply force, then also relative velocity is not zero. It is like solid. Are you getting it? So the numerator is also zero. Tell me, what is the unit?
Newton second per meter.
Newton. See, don't tell me unit Newton. Tell me in term. Tell me the dimension in mass, length, and time. Thank you. question. A metal block is there. This is a metal block, alright, which has cross section area 0.1 meter square. It is connected to 0.01 kg mass like this. The thickness of the fluid film is 0.3 mm. The object is moving with a velocity of 0.085 meter per second. 085. This object is moving with constant velocity of 0.085 meter per second. You need to find the coefficient of viscosity. This chapter is done in the school, right? Okay. got that answer? Okay. I think this you can do by direct formula substitution. It is force per unit area divided by velocity by L. Now here I know what is L. L is my D. V is this. Come here. This is the velocity. A is this. I don't know what is F. Okay. Now since this is moving with constant velocity, can I say acceleration is zero? Acceleration is zero, right? Velocity is constant. Acceleration is zero. All right. So if I do the force balance over here, this is mg, this is t. So t is equal to mg. If acceleration of this block is zero, acceleration of that block is also zero. So t is equal to mg. And then I do the force balance on this block. This is t, and this is the viscous force on the block. Because on the fluid layer, the block is exerting force this side. So this fluid will have resistive force F on the block. So T is equal to F because acceleration of this block is zero. And it need not be that acceleration of the block is zero. There might be the case that it has some acceleration. So T minus F will be M into A. That way you get the value of F. F is T, which is 0.01 kg into G. And then substitute this value of F. F is 0.01 into G. On this equation, you will get that answer. Okay? Any doubt? Clear, right? Alright. Slow. Okay, guys, now have you seen that an object, when an object is sinking in a fluid, alright, what are the forces acting on it? Gravity and buoyant force. Why buoyant force comes? Because of the pressure difference. Alright, buoyant force is an outcome of the pressure difference. Now, when the object is sinking inside the fluid which is in contact with the object, for example, if there is this beaker inside which an object is moving down, okay? So, the fluid which is in contact with the surface will move with the solid. Yes or no? That is what our basic assumption is, that if a fluid is in contact with a solid, okay, the contact means that it is moving with the solid. If solid is at rest, that surface is at rest. If solid is moving, that layer of the fluid which is in contact with the solid is also moving with the solid. Okay, now if the layer which is in contact with the solid moves with the solid, will the fluid resist that if it has viscosity? Yes or no? So because of the viscosity, the fluid will resist its motion down. So there will be one additional force that will act on an object apart from gravity and buoyant force, that is viscous force, that we have ignored earlier. Okay, now since we are talking about the viscous force, there will be a viscous force as well in a real fluid that will be applied in such scenario. Okay, now what do you think this viscous force will depend on? Viscous force, when an object is moving inside the water or inside the fluid, should depend on what? Should it depend on mass? Does it matter how much is the mass of an object? Mass of the object will affect the gravity force. What fluid is applying, that has nothing to do with what is the mass of an object. Area in contact. Are you getting it? The area, the surface area in contact. So basically you are saying that geometry, viscous force is proportional to what is the geometry. Now it is difficult to quantify with geometry. It could be surface area, it could be something else, it could be surface area raised to power 2 or something else, I don't know. Okay, but definitely viscous force has to do with what is the geometry of the object. All of you understood this? Okay, see, you can consider, for example, let's say you have two spheres of different masses that are moving inside the fluids with same velocity. Does it matter which object is heavier than? It doesn't matter what fluid is applying. Okay? So, geometry, it depends on what else viscous force should depend on? Viscous force should depend on what is the velocity of the object. What else? Coefficient of viscosity, that you should have told the first. It should depend on what is the property of the fluid itself, which is coefficient of viscosity. Are you getting it? Alright. Now, see, quantifying these two things is easy. But quantifying the geometry is not easy. Are you getting it? So for different kinds of shapes and sizes, I will get a different equation. Alright? But in our syllabus, viscous force on a sphere is there. Alright? It is called Stokes' law. Alright? If you change the shape, if you say that what is the viscous force on a cube when it is sinking inside a liquid, I don't know. We don't have a ready-made expression for that. You need to calculate it. Are you getting it? But what Stokes have done, Stokes has empirically found out an expression which is true for a sphere. Alright? So, next topic is Stokes' law. Please write down. Write down, Stokes' law gives us an expression for Stokes' law gives us an expression for the viscous force, for the viscous flow force on a spherical object. Okay? Alright? It only tells about what is the viscous force on a spherical object when it is completely inside. When it is completely inside the fluid, it should not be partially inside, completely it should be inside. Getting it? And this is what the expression is. Viscous force is 6 pi eta a into velocity of the sphere, where a is a radius. Now, does it matter whether it is hollow sphere or a solid sphere? It doesn't matter. Because viscous force is applied on the surface. It should only depend on how the surface is. Doesn't matter what is inside. Fine? So, this is the expression for the Stokes' law. Any doubt in this? And please write down the direction of viscous force will be. What is the direction of viscous force will be? Upward? What do you think? Acha, what if the object is moving like this? Then there will not be any viscous force? Against the velocity. Please write down, direction of viscous force will be opposite to the velocity. It is like a drag force. Alright? It's like air drag, or you can say kinetic friction, sort of. But they are not exactly same. I'm just telling you how they correlate. Alright? So it is against the velocity. Now we do a numerical based on this itself. Please write down. No doubts, right? Here is an expression for viscous force. Please note down. You have a beaker as always. The density of the fluid inside the beaker is rho. Okay? And inside the fluid, there is a spherical object. The density of this object is sigma. The radius is a. Fine. Now this is sinking inside the liquid. If it is sinking, what should the relation between sigma and rho? Sigma must be more than rho, otherwise it will float. It can displace little bit volume whose mass will be equal to the mass of the object itself and will float. Alright? Now if sigma is more than rho and you leave it from the surface, it will go down because of the gravity, and buoyant force is not sufficient to make it stop or decrease its velocity, so it will continuously increase its velocity. Net force is downward, acceleration is there. So what will happen? Velocity will keep on increasing. If velocity keeps on increasing, viscous force will? Viscous force is what? Viscous force is 6 pi eta a into v. If velocity keeps on increasing, viscous force will keep on increasing, and it is acting upward when you drop it. It is moving down, right? Viscous force will be upward. So if its velocity keeps on increasing, viscous force also keeps on increasing, there will be a point at which viscous force will balance out the other forces and net force will become zero. Right now, when velocity is very less, gravity force is more than the buoyant force. As velocity increases, the viscous force keeps on increasing, and at some point, viscous force will be able to balance out the difference between gravity and the buoyant force. And from that point onwards, net force is zero, so acceleration will be zero. But velocity will be constant. Alright? And that velocity is called terminal velocity. Terminal is something that happens after a long time at the end. Okay? So, this velocity which remains, which becomes constant after some time is called terminal velocity. Vt is referred as terminal velocity. You need to find out what is that terminal velocity. Equate net force to zero for the terminal velocity. Mass you have to write in terms of density. Mass is sigma into 4 by 3 pi a cube. if you are writing MG code. All of you done? This is just balance of process.
Sink inside and stop. Buoyant force will be able to balance it. And it also tells us that sigma should be more than rho. Terminal velocity cannot be negative. So if you drop something, it will not just jump upwards. Velocity cannot be negative. Fine? Any doubts? We have equated net force to be zero. Is it clear? No doubts, right? Are you getting it? Have you done laws of motion properly?
You are studying on your own before this.
Both of you, you are studying on your own. Please go to our YouTube channel. First, subscribe it. And then you can watch our videos. Okay. Don't talk. Now, we will be solving a numerical. One more numerical. Draw a bigger bucket. You know, at times in JEE, they'll just draw something to make you feel that it is something different. So, sometimes people who don't study properly, they're like, oh, there should be something because of this. You know, this is not a proper bucket. So, they start putting their brain, okay, why it is like this, cut like that. Okay? But, anyways, you guys are smarter. Suppose this is a scenario. The density of the fluid is rho. Keep quiet. Density of this is rho. Okay. The density of this object is sigma 1. Density of that object is sigma 2. The radius of this is A. Radius of that is B. Okay. Fine. Now, you need to find out the tension in this string which connects them. If coefficient of viscosity is eta, at the time when terminal velocity has reached, find out tension at the time when terminal velocity has reached. or not? Has to be same, otherwise spring will become slack. That is the difference. This is sigma 1 into 4 by 3 pi a cube g. Stop talking. This is rho into 4 by 3 pi a cube g. And there will be a viscous force 6 pi eta into a into b. Okay? Pi eta a b plus the buoyant force minus t minus sigma 1 4 by 3 pi a cube g is equal to 0. How many of you got both the equations correct? Ab kya karna hai hum logo? What we should do? We need to eliminate v, right? We need to eliminate V. So keep 6 pi eta AB this side, 6 pi eta BB that side, and divide it. V will be gone. Getting it? If you subtract, this is B and this is A. You subtracted and removed it. Congratulations. Why you do that? Okay, and then you can find the terminal velocity also. In this case, terminal velocity will not be equal to 2 by 9 a square eta is rho minus sigma by g. Okay, because there is a string also. Got it? So like this you have to do. Started running opposite. So what are you doing?